Welcome to Fairhaven Baptist Church and the commencement services for Fairhaven Christian Academy and Fairhaven Baptist College. While we're here for commencement exercises, it is the commencement of a school and college that's part of a church. And much of this evening will be much like a church service. We need to be respectful to the graduates and performers, so please refrain from walking in and out, answering cell phones, maybe just check, make sure those are off or on silent, taking pictures, video, or disturbing the service in some way. There'll be plenty of time afterward to use our cameras. You will hear some musical performances, students will be receiving awards, certificates, diplomas, degrees. And some students will be giving testimonies of how God helped them and strengthened them during their time of schooling. It's appropriate to congratulate students at the proper time, but if you'd like to praise God with them, a hearty amen or praise the Lord is a good way to do that. We've tried to group the various parts of the service in this way. We will begin with some performances and award presentations. You're, of course, welcome to applaud during that time if you desire. We will then have an offering time with a special arrangement of a sacred song, some other sacred singing, and a sermon from God's Word. During this portion, we ask that you not applaud. And then at the end, we'll present the graduates for the respective diplomas and degrees. Please stand with me as we sing our national anthem.
Oh, say, can you sing by the dawn?
Remain standing as Pastor Olson comes to lead us in prayer.
Father, we thank you for this evening, all the hard work, countless prayers have gone in, Lord, to see the success of these graduates, Lord, the academy, the college, Lord, just an excitement that's in the air tonight, Lord, we're thankful for that. We're thankful, Lord, for the sacrifice of parents that have put so much into these students and the teachers. Now we pray that you'd bless every part of our service. May the singing be a blessing to our hearts. Encourage us through the testimonies, Lord, and to see how you worked in the lives of some of our young people. And I pray that you'd be with Brother Samples as he brings the challenge from your word, that it would be meaningful and helpful and insightful to all of us. Lord, may you be glorified through all that's said and done tonight. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, what an exciting evening for sure. A buzz in this room, and appropriately so. For some who may not know, Fairhaven Baptist College was started in 1977. A freshman in our first class would have been born when Dwight D. Eisenhower was president and would have entered the college under Jimmy Carter. A freshman in this year of college would have been born when George W. Bush was president and will graduate when I'm not sure who will be president. The history of Fairhaven Baptist College covers all or portions of 6 decades. That's a blessing. We praise the Lord tonight for longevity. This year completes year 46 for us. We thank the Lord for continuity. This is illustrated in part by the fact that exactly half of our graduates tonight had at least one parent graduate from Fairhaven Baptist College. This year's graduating class is comprised of students from 16 different churches in 10 states and even 3 foreign countries. We pray to the Lord for his favor as we move forward. The spirit desired for the students in this graduating class is just this: humble yet determined.
Thank you, Pastor Mitchell. While we want to maintain the serious nature of a church service, these are commencement exercises, and most likely you've not heard music like we have planned for tonight in church recently. Maybe not since last year. For many years, we have prepared a special song in 3 categories for our graduation service. The first category is a patriotic or march selection. We're grateful that in his providence, God placed us here in America. As Americans, we believe it's proper to teach our children to have a Christian view and appreciation for the country that he's given us. We'll close the night with the popular patriotic prayer, God Bless America. And our patriotic selection tonight is Semper Fidelis by John Philip Sousa. I knew I'd get some responses for that one. The march takes its title from the motto of the United States Marine Corps, Semper Fidelis, always faithful. It was dedicated to those who inspired it, the officers and men of the United States Marine Corps. In Sousa's own words, "I wrote Semper Fidelis one night while in tears after my comrades of the Marine Corps had sung their famous hymn at Quantico." Sometime after composing the march, Semper Fidelis gained recognition as the official march of the United States Marine Corps, and Sousa regarded it as his best march, musically speaking, and it has become one of his most popular marches. Please enjoy our graduation orchestra as they play Semper Fidelis.
Thank you. At this point, I'd like to recognize some high school students for accomplishments through the school year. There'll be several of these. We'll have them come down front, and once they're all gathered, we can give them a round of applause at the end. The first set of awards is some awards based on subjects in school. Here we've selected students who have an excellent grade point average and have also maintained a good testimony at school. This year for the 11th and 12th grade history award, we have Reagan Snyder. A lot of these will be behind me. 9th and 10th grade history is Kate Mitchell. 11th and 12th grade English is Melody Schreiber. 9th and 10th grade English is Cherith Schreiber. 9th through 12th Bible is all one class. This year the award goes to Kate Mitchell. 3rd Calculus, probably the best class in the entire school, goes to Jonathan Rose this year. Algebra 2 goes to Wyatt Boschaleski. Algebra 1 is Marissa Ramos. Physics class for 11th and 12th graders goes to Reagan Snyder, already down front. And 9th and 10th grade physical science goes to Cherith Schreiber. And we have two band awards, one for senior band, one for junior band. Senior band is Adeline Wilcox. And junior band is Cabrera McWright. All right, next I'd like to recognize the senior class valedictorian and salutatorian. This is a straight grade calculation from 9th through 12th grade. This year, the senior class valedictorian is Luke Armacost, and the salutatorian is Jonathan Rose. We have one more award to recognize. There's four students for this one. The American Christian Honor Society. This is open for students in 10th through 12th grade who have an excellent academic record, have a good Christian testimony in and out of school, and exercise student leadership. This year we have four students, two in 10th grade, Cabrera McWright and Chair Schreiber. One in 11th grade, Melody Schreiber. And one senior, Jonathan Rose. Let's give them a round of applause.
All those hours on their instrument helped them in all those other classes. I'm sure it had something to do with that. Our next musical selection is a classical piece. There's a wealth of challenging music that we can choose from to stretch the abilities God has given us. And our classical selection is the overture to the play titled Egmont by Ludwig Beethoven. Heroism was close to Beethoven's personality, and it was a major concern of his time. So it's not surprising that in his comparatively few compositions of theater music, Beethoven was most attracted to protagonists who dared much against oppressive forces. And Egmont is certainly a case in point. In 1809, he was commissioned to compose music for the premiere of the play by von Goethe. This was von Goethe's interpretation of Count Egmont's 16th century struggle for Dutch liberty against the autocratic imperial rule of Spain. In the play, Egmont is imprisoned and sentenced to death, and when Clarchen, his mistress, fails to free him, she commits suicide, And then before his own death, Egmont delivers a rousing speech, and his execution becomes a victorious martyrdom in the fight against oppression. Beethoven's music begins with a powerful overture that summarizes the course of the story from its ominous, slow introduction, suggesting the oppressive tread of Spain, to the transformation of tragedy into triumph in the brilliant ending. The overture to Egmont.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Abigail Samples. I had the privilege of growing up in a ministry family and learned early on the joys of the ministry along with the sorrows. I was saved at the age of 7, but began doubting in my early teen years. Thankfully, God has given me his continual reassurance that I am his and nothing I do will change that. Even though I grew up surrounded by the ministry, there came a point when I had to decide personally if I was willing to surrender my life to it. At a young age, I remember surrendering my life to whatever God wanted me to do, but it is not just a one-time thing. I know that daily, I must completely surrender myself and trust the Lord for his guidance. One of those steps of surrender was coming to Fairhaven Baptist College in the fall of 2019. I remember stepping onto campus that first day, so excited and yet so unsure if this is where God wanted me. But as I was singing in the first chapel this semester, God gave me an overwhelming assurance that this is where he wanted me. And I am so grateful for the time that I got to spend here at Fairhaven. He has been so good to me through it all. Throughout my college years, it seems that God has used little things to show me more areas that I needed to surrender in. I am thankful for those things that stretched me, that nudged me out of my comfort zone. The Lord has given me the desire to educate children. While this is not easy and sometimes a very daunting task, I know that this is his plan for me at this point in my life. This coming August, I will be moving to Woodbridge, Virginia, and begin teaching at Heritage Christian School and serving in Heritage Baptist Church under Pastor Mark Carpenter. I am so excited for the opportunity to not only give children a good education, but also teach them about Christ. Without Christ, their lives will be incomplete and hopeless. I wish to give them the hope that there is someone who loves them and has a special plan for their life. I want to thank and praise the Lord tonight for all that he has done in my life. First, I want to thank him for the privilege to grow up in the ministry. Through the faithfulness of my parents and other prominent figures, I've been able to see how the ministry changes lives and brings God the glory. I am thankful for my parents who have always been there for me. They taught me right when I was young, and have continued to encourage me to follow the Lord and His perfect will. Thank you, Mom and Dad, for showing Christ through your day-to-day lives. I love you both very much. I also want to thank the Lord for the friends that I have made. Each relationship has its precious memories. Memories of laughter, encouragement, tears, sharing our desires for the future. I treasure each and every one of you. I know that God has blessed me to give me such wonderful friends. On behalf of our class, thank you to all the staff at Fairhaven Baptist Church and College. Your faithfulness to this ministry does not go unnoticed. We appreciate all that you have done to invest in our lives, past, present, and future. The education that we have received will continue to teach us as we work in our ministries. As each of us graduates go our separate ways, I pray that we remember who should be our focus, who is in control, who is the one we can turn to. Our Heavenly Father is right beside us as we do the work that He has called us to. Psalm 139, 7 through 10 says, "Whither shall I go from thy spirit? Or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me." Let us remember who is really on the throne. Our God, my God, will be with us. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Elise Buttrell, and it has certainly been a growing experience to attend Fairhaven Baptist College. When I arrived on the campus as a little lost dorm student, I wasn't even sure what major I should study. That night, I mentioned this to my new room captain, Sarah Edwards, and she said in her very frank and Sarah Edwards way, "Registration is tomorrow, you sure better figure that out." I did, although it did take me a summer. But this was still in God's timing, as He was able to use the testimony of my grandmother, Beverly Samuel, unbeknownst to her, to show me that I was to take secondary education. One of the biggest indicators that I was where God wanted me to be was His enabling. And what I mean by that is God provided for me to attend school here. The first example I have of this comes in my freshman year. My freshman class was the class of the pandemic. That spring semester, we went home for an extended spring break while the rest of the world tried to sort itself out. While most people during that time had to remain indoors, the Lord made it possible for me to start a new job considered essential to deliver groceries. I was able to work for all of that spring and summer and pay off my school bill for that remaining semester. Secondly, another example happens during the summer of my sophomore and junior year. God had laid it on the heart of Mr. Ramos to ask me to help at a VBS at a church near my home in Maryland. I went, and I was definitely encouraged by the new church members' excitement towards the event. The following summer, not wanting to miss anything, I went back again to help a second time. Again, the Lord provided for me as He laid it on the hearts of those church members to bless me with a generous scholarship. I had called my mom a few months before saying, "Mom, I don't know how I'm going to make these bills pay out." And she said, "Alicia, you need to trust the Lord. He has already provided for you." At that point in time, I had no idea what she was talking about, but it was certainly a wonderful blessing to see Him provide for me that way. It has been encouraging during my 4 years of college to see the Lord provide for my big needs and my small ones. Going forward, I plan to return home to Hunt Valley, Maryland, where my dad is a pastor, and help in the church there. I know there are lots of opportunities to serve and be a blessing, and I hope to take what I have learned as a student here at Fairhaven to help me be a better Christian and servant for Him. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Brandon Starr, and I would like to thank everyone who has come tonight to show support to us graduates. As I look back over these past 4 years, there are countless people who have made an impact on my life, whether that be family, friends, teachers, pastors, ministry leaders, or laymen in the church. I would like to start by thanking each of you who have invested in my life. My dad would always tell me growing up, "People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care." I am so grateful God has placed many of you along my path who have cared for me and taught me how to become more like Christ. I had the privilege of being raised in a pastor's home in Brogue, Pennsylvania. Growing up, I did not always call that a privilege. There was a time when people would always ask me, "Are you going to be a pastor like your dad and grandpa?" It annoyed me, and I would always tell them, "No, I don't think so." It took until the summer after I graduated from high school for the Lord to open my eyes to the advantages of growing up in a pastor's home. During that summer, the Lord used a camp message to call me to preach, changing the course of my life. I am now so thankful for the opportunity to grow up in a pastor's home and see the many different aspects of ministry. In the spring of 2020, God brought me here to Fairhaven. Over the past 3.5 years, I've had the opportunity to double major in pastoral theology and sacred music. I've also had the blessing of serving in many ministries, including bus ministry, Sunday school, junior church, choir, and nursing home, as well as being a part of the college ensemble for 2 years. I don't have a favorite ministry, but I really enjoyed traveling with the ensemble and being able to see many churches striving to serve the Lord. Each time we visited a church, it was such a blessing to see that we were being used by God to lift up his people. During this time, God really gave me a burden for evangelism and helping churches across America. My prayer is to someday use this experience to start a music evangelistic team that will encourage churches with godly music and preaching. Over the past few weeks, I began to take some time in my devotions to reflect on some goals for this next chapter of my life. During these times, the Lord kept bringing Matthew 6:33 to mind. "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." Over the past few months, I struggled to see God's plan for me after graduation. Even though there were times I would question him and even get upset with him, he used it to teach me the real meaning of this verse. I am learning that each time I choose to seek God's kingdom first, he will take care of the rest. Fellow graduates, if I could challenge you to set one goal for the next chapter of your life, it would be to put the kingdom of God first and watch as he blesses you beyond measure. To this point, I can say without a doubt that the Lord has indeed added all these things in my life. I will be getting married at the end of the summer and will immediately begin serving on staff at Hunt Valley Baptist Church in Hunt Valley, Maryland. Tonight, as this chapter of life comes to an end and another begins, I am excited to seek God's kingdom first and watch him do the rest. Thank you.
I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Good evening. My name is John Bottrell, and I am from the tiny town of Tyner, North Carolina. Though my current home is in North Carolina, most of my life I spent in the state of Pennsylvania. That is where I would like to begin this evening. I had the amazing privilege of being born into a Christian home in Airville, Pennsylvania, where I was taught the Bible from an early age, and also taken to church any times the doors were open. Though I was constantly taught the gospel, I never accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior till I was 12 years old. I knew what the gospel was, but it never translated to my heart. One night, I went to the verses I had heard so many times and accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. Since I have been saved, God has been able to direct me in my decisions throughout my life. As soon as I was saved, I knew that my devotions should not become a habit to follow, but a person to be known. I knew that I would not go anywhere in my Christian life if I forsook what God had given me to live the Christian life. As I began to grow in my walk with the Lord, I began to ask the Lord what he would have me do with my life. I told the Lord on multiple occasions, after a sermon or a camp meeting or something similar to that, that I would do whatever he wanted when I grew up, but not right now. One day, as I was doing my devotions, I came across the passage that I quoted to you at the beginning, Romans 12:1. "I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service." For 3 days, I could not get that passage out of my mind. I had surrendered my occupation to the Lord, but had not yet surrendered my day-to-day life. On May 28th, 2016, at the age of 15, I finally gave in to the Lord and offered my life as a living sacrifice unto him. thereby giving him full control, not only of my future, but my present as well. I vowed that I would listen to the Holy Spirit's leading in my life, not just for the big decisions, but for the day-to-day decisions as well. As I began to get closer to college age, I began to seek the Lord's will in receiving training for what the Lord would have me do. I had the wonderful opportunity of coming to multiple Empowered Youth conferences to experience Fairhaven Baptist College. When I would attend these conferences, the Lord would work on my heart in many ways through the preaching and the various things that happened there. I knew that I needed to go to a Bible college that would not only teach me how to serve the Lord better, but a place that would draw my heart closer to the Lord. It was because of the preaching and other similar things that I felt led to attend Fairhaven Baptist College in the fall of 2019. As the years of college quickly went by, I began to pray about where God would direct me once I had graduated from college. While serving as a summer intern at Bible Baptist Church in McConnellsburg, Pennsylvania, I received a call from Pastor Mitchell. He asked me to pray about coming on staff here at Fairhaven. After praying about it for a few weeks, the Lord directed me to accept that offer. Lord willing, on August 4th of this year, I will marry my sweetheart, Juliana, and we will have the privilege of serving the Lord together here at Fairhaven Baptist Church. In conclusion, I would like to thank the many people that have helped me get to this point in my life. Mom, I know that countless hours of work and toil went into my life, from my quite eventful birth to this present moment. You have loved me and have tried to teach me to serve the Lord. The incredible amount of time spent homeschooling me and training me has certainly been an extremely large part of how I'm standing here right now. Dad, thank you for being a faithful father. As I grow older, I realize more and more the sacrifice you made to simply be there. The memories we share from the many adventures that have been taken are beyond any price tag could ever offer. However, more important than all of that, you taught me to be a man. A man that serves God with all his heart. A man that works hard and trusts God with the rest. To my brothers, Davey, Joe, and Josh, I thank you for always supporting me and teaching me many important life lessons, like patience. Though sometimes you three got on my nerves, I would not trade our times together for anything. You three are certainly my closest friends. Thank you, Grandma and Grandpa Woodward and Bottrell, for always encouraging me and supporting me as I've grown up. Your influence has had a great impression upon my life. Uncles, aunts, and cousins, thank you for simply doing the Lord's will. The simple fact of having all my family going the same direction is a tremendous encouragement to me to follow the Lord as well. Teachers, thank you for your faithfulness in teaching us how to better serve the Lord. By God's grace, your teaching will not be in vain, but will go on to teach others for many more years. Classmates, you have certainly become some of my closest friends. The hardworking spirit that you all have had throughout college has been one that, if continued, can have a wonderful impact on this needy world. And most importantly, I would like to thank my Lord and Savior. Amen. He has been so good to me throughout the entirety of my life. No matter how far I have strayed from him, he has always been very faithful and forgiving. As I cling to his unfaltering promises, I know I can face the unknown future. It is with this in mind that I seek to live my life as a living sacrifice, emptied out unto my worthy Savior. Though the world may believe this is to be a waste, I consider it the greatest honor and simply my reasonable service to my wonderful Lord. Thank you.
In a moment, we'll receive our graduation offering. The offering assists with our campus updates, renovations, and repairs, and we strive to keep our tuition costs low. So this offering is a great help. You can give in the offering plate as it comes by, or later on by going to fhbc.me/give. Thank you for your gifts. As the ushers come, I will mention a few things about the offertory song. We'll be playing an arrangement of Blessed Be the Name by Camp Kirkland. Blessed Be the Name is a well-known sacred song. The verses were written by William Clark and the refrain by Ralph Hudson. The verses start with a declaration of praise to the Father and then proceeds to praise Jesus the Son through the rest of the song. The refrain is quite repetitive and reminds me of the many psalms that are filled with blessing the Lord over and over throughout them. Here are two references in Scripture to think on as we play. Psalm 113, 1 through 6 says, "Praise ye the Lord. Praise, O ye servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like unto the Lord our God, who dwelleth on high, who humbleth himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth? And then Daniel, at the end of chapter 2 of his book, Daniel chapter 2, Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changeth the times and the seasons. He removeth kings and setteth up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him." Let's pray as we receive our offering. Heavenly Father, thank you again for this evening where we can celebrate the accomplishments of the students that have been here, and thank you for how you've sustained all of us through this time, especially the graduates. Right now, as we receive this offering from those that give for your work, we ask that you'd bless those that give and that you'd help us to use it to further the work you've given us to do here. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand with me now as we sing "Blessed Be the Name." It's in our hymnal. It's also in the program. It's number 32 in our hymnal. Graduates will be moving around during this time, and so there's no confusion later on. If you do have to leave during the message, we have some chairs reserved in the back for you to sit in and not have to disrupt the service by finding your seat again. Now we'll sing number 32, "All Praise to Him Who Reigns Above."
All praise to
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated.
Man, that is so true, isn't it? We're given so much. I owe God a whole bunch. Oh, there's no better life than giving everything you've been given back to Him. What a special evening. And when God's Word is opened on this particular evening, it's a special time as well. I'm glad that Pastor Aaron Samples could be with us tonight. He's the senior pastor of Grace Baptist Church in Urbana, Ohio. He grew up in a Christian home in Knoxville, Tennessee, underneath the ministry of Temple Baptist Church. After graduating from college, Pastor Samples and his wife served at Bayview Baptist Church in Washington, Illinois, till the Lord called him to Urbana in 2010. The Lord has blessed them with three children, two of which attend our college. His daughter, Abby, one of the seniors graduating this year, she was the first one to give her testimony tonight. Levi and Bethany Armacost, as well as Sarah Olson and Anna Zadarsky, are four of our graduates that serve alongside Pastor Samples at Grace Baptist Church. So again, what a special time when God's word is opened to us on this special evening. So listen closely and don't miss what God has for you just now.
Thanks, brother. Okay. Amen. Let's take the word of God tonight and we will go to Matthew chapter number 25. Matthew chapter 25. Well, it is a great honor to be here and on this evening and this special time for these high school graduates and these college graduates. And if I heard right, Luke Armacost, valedictorian, that's amazing, all right? And your brother works for me, but I just didn't see it, all right? But anyway, all right? And that's amazing. Miracles still happen, but anyway, all right? But what a great blessing it is. The music has been tremendous, and I'm very thankful for this place. I'm thankful for the influence that they have on my own children's life. And, of course, my son Caleb is here, and just finishing up his second year, and then Abby, my daughter, and finishing college here. I remember when we came and brought her and dropped her off. That was the most horrible time of my life, you know. And how many parents, you understand what I'm talking about, when you drop them off, when you raise your hand and leave. And my wife and I didn't talk a whole lot. It was a kind of a miserable trip on the way back. But we knew she was doing what the Lord wanted her to do. And there's no really greater joy, I think, as parents than your children walk in truth. And the truth of the matter is, there's no greater joy for a church or for a college than for its graduates, whether they be high school or college, to walk in truth, to walk in that truth. And I know, as the song was given tonight, that a lot has been put in me. A lot has been invested in my life. And I know, therefore, that a lot is required. And may God help us tonight. This evening, I want to preach on this subject, God's call for faithfulness. God's call for faithfulness. Now, we come to a very special passage in Matthew chapter number 25. It's a story, a parable that the Lord Jesus gives to us. And it deals with our faithfulness. And I think sometimes that, I know when I was a graduate, I wanted to leave college, and I guess there was a part of me that I wanted to, in a sense, be successful. And I wanted others to think that I was successful. But you know, it's possible to be viewed successful in the eyes of men and be unfaithful in the eyes of God. And the truth is, we should desire tonight one thing, and that is to answer God's call for faithfulness. Amen. Years ago, I heard the story about a man by the name of George Phillips. He lived in Meriden, Mississippi. He was a Southern boy. And one night, him and his wife were getting ready for bed, and he looked outside, and he had a large barn out there, and he noticed the light was on. He thought to himself, I didn't leave the light on, but he said, honey, I'm going to go take care of this and turn the light out. And he walked out on his back porch getting ready to descend the stairs to go out. And he saw that there were people in his barn and they were stealing things from his barn, at least three of them. He went back in, he called the local sheriff department and he said, hey, there's people here robbing my barn right now. And they said, well, sir, are you in danger? He said, well, I don't think so. He said, are they in your house? He said, no. And they said, look, we're busy tonight. You lock the doors. We'll be there as soon as we can. So the man was a little irritated about that. And he waited 60 seconds. And he called back to the sheriff's department. He said, hey, that call I just made, forget it. I've shot and killed every one of them. He hung up the phone. 5 minutes later, three police cars showed up. An armed response unit and two ambulances came. They got there. Of course, they caught the guys red-handed. They locked them up. And then The man who had answered the call and said, "Hey, I thought you told me that you had shot and killed them." And the man looked at him and said, "Well, I thought you said that nobody was available." Well, can I tell you tonight, I think sometimes in the matter of urgency, we make it a point to do things. And I believe that this is a call tonight for these graduates, that this is a time of urgency. If we're going to do anything for Jesus Christ, we've got to do it now. It is not one day, it is not someday, but it's now. Not only now is the time of salvation, but now is the time to serve our Savior and King, Jesus Christ. And a part of that is answering God's call for faithfulness. We come to Matthew chapter 25, and let us begin in verse number 14, if you would please. And the Word of God tells us in Matthew 25, beginning in verse 14, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same and made them other 5 talents. And likewise, he that had received 2, he also gained other 2. Verse 18, but he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. And after a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them. His Lord said unto him, Well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid, and went, and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine. His Lord answered and said unto him, Thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not, and gather where I have not strawed. Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury. Take therefore the talent from him and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. For unto every one that hath shall be given, and he that hath, he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath." Brethren, as we read this portion of Scripture tonight, I find that the emphasis in this passage is on the faithfulness that God is calling each and every one of us to. These graduates here have graduated high school. They have graduated college. And many, especially of these college students, are going to go out and serve the Lord. But really, the answer of what we should answer every day is God's call for faithfulness. Would you join me in prayer as we begin? Father in heaven, I thank you for this privilege tonight to be able to stand here and to be able to preach. And Father, I pray that you will enable each of us to be faithful. Lord, we know that it is looking unto you, the faithful one, that then and only then can we be faithful. And Father, I pray that you will enable me tonight to preach and do what I could never do in my own strength. And I pray you'd be glorified tonight, and that our eyes would be drawn to you, the great faithful one. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. I believe this evening that faithfulness is possible for all believers, regardless of your education, regardless of your talents, and regardless of your gifts, that God has made a way for us to be faithful to Him. In fact, the Bible says in Proverbs 26, it says, most men will proclaim everyone his own goodness, but a faithful man who can find. A faithful man. God is looking for faithful men and women tonight who will seek to be faithful to him, because that is what is true success in the eyes of God, is faithfulness. You see, often we get in this bad habit of comparing ourselves with other people. I can remember in college being a, you know, comparing myself to other preachers and thinking, I don't have their gifts and I don't have their talents and I don't have their abilities. Well, no two people have the same gifts and the same talents and the same opportunities, but comparison always cripples our Christian life. Because the truth of the matter is, we're never going to be faithful to God if we are comparing ourselves with other people. And may I encourage these graduates tonight not to have your eyes on the other classmates, on others who are serving the Lord. Just keep your eyes on the faithful one, Jesus Christ. Because he is the one who enables us to be faithful. And by the way, as long as we are looking at others, you know, there's a danger in doing that. By the way, you can always find someone that's not doing as much as you are doing, and therefore comparing yourself, thinking, I am doing a great job. I must be faithful. But when our eyes are on Christ, and as the Bible says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, that is the great key tonight. You see, tonight, young people and all of us here, I want you to understand your own personal accountability to the Lord Jesus Christ. That begins, number one, tonight. We have the responsibility of faithfulness. Now, God has entrusted all of us with different responsibilities. We are responsible. But what are those responsibilities? It is all about being faithful to the Lord. In fact, God has delivered to you certain things. Let's go back to our passage, because I want you to see some things that I think are so important. And we go back to verse number 14, our beginning verse, where the Bible says, for the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country who called, I love that, his own servants. Do you know that God calls each and every one of us? There are not some who are called and some who are not called. We have been called. What are we called to? Faithfulness before God. I'm a pastor, and that is what God has called me to, but I'm called to be faithful in what he has given me to do. But I've got men in my church who are farmers and factory workers, but those men are faithful doing what God has entrusted with them to do. So we have a responsibility to faithfulness, but the Bible goes on to say, who called his own servants, and look at this, and delivered unto them his goods. So important for all of us to understand that God has delivered unto us his goods. Amen. Do you know tonight that your gifts are not your gifts? They are gifts that God has given to you. Amen. Do you know tonight that the influence that God has put into your life, that God has given you that? He has entrusted you with that influence. I can think back on my life, and I can think back on a basketball coach who influenced me greatly. I can think back to an English teacher. Now, I didn't learn much, but she had a great influence in my life, all right? That's why I married an English major, and she helps me out greatly, all right? But, you know, I can think back to a pastor and a coach, and I can think back to my own parents, and I can think back to people that took an interest in my life, and God has entrusted me with that influence, and God has entrusted me with that. In fact, he has delivered unto me his goods. That's why we can never really be proud about anything, because they are his goods. Amen. We should never be arrogant about anything that God has blessed us with, because he has delivered unto us his goods. Amen. And people tonight, young people here, the graduates, God has delivered unto you his goods. And there is a responsibility of faithfulness. In fact, we all have responsibilities that have been assigned to us by God. And what God blesses and what God rewards is faithfulness in what he has delivered unto us. Do you know that I am not going to stand before God with other people's responsibilities? I am going to stand before the Lord one day with what He has delivered unto me, His goods. And that helps me. Can I tell you what that does? That gives freedom to me. That brings liberty to life because I'm not standing before another person. I am not going to be compared to another person. I have my acceptance in Jesus Christ right here and now. I am accepted in the beloved, but God has called me to be faithful to His responsibilities in life. Every one of us tonight, we have our responsibility to faithfulness. Now, there are two types of responsibilities, those that we enjoy doing and those that we don't enjoy doing. But a faithful Christian fulfills his responsibility, whether he feels like doing it or not. But an unfaithful Christian does what he feels like doing and doesn't do what he doesn't feel like doing. You see, I love this passage here where he has delivered unto them his goods. You graduates, you will be delivered a diploma tonight. You will receive that. What a blessing that is. But as you receive the diploma tonight, I want you to understand that you are also being delivered by God what He has given to you. Things that He has for you to fulfill. Responsibility to be faithful to Him in the areas of life. Amen. Oh, may God take this, or may God help us to take this to heart. That what God has delivered to me, it's important because it's what He has given to me. It is significant because He has delivered it unto me. But it is not mine. Can I say to you tonight, I'm so thankful for my wife. We will have been married 25 years in July. And I'm going to tell you something. I think she deserves a crown for that. I think it's called the martyr's crown, you know, something like that. But I thank God for my wife. But you know how I look at her? I didn't always look at it this way, but I look at her as God has gifted her to me. It's a gift from God that I am to cherish, that I am to love, that I am to care for. She is really God's daughter. She belongs to Him, and God has entrusted me with her, and I'm so grateful for that. The children that God has given to me, they're not mine, really. They are God's. They belong to Him, and my wife and I remember, of course, today is a special day for my wife and I, our daughter graduating from college, and, you know, lots of thoughts run through your mind, you know? And I remember when she was just little and tiny, and I remember when she wouldn't want to sit in her car seat, you know? And I'd put her in there, and she would straighten out just like a board, you know? And I would say, honey, you better straighten, you better bend, because if not, you know, there's going to be other things to make you bend, all right? And I remember she didn't want to be buckled in. And I remember I have to smack that little leg and then the eyes cry and then she would bend and surrender. But can I tell you something tonight? I recognize that God has entrusted me with her to train her, to raise her in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord, and my two sons to train and raise them. But God's delivered them to me. They are His goods. They are for His purpose and for His glory. And tonight, all of our responsibilities are for Him, and He has delivered them to us. It is special. It is on purpose, and we must take the responsibility in a high regard. We see tonight, number one, the responsibility to faithfulness. Think of this, delivered unto them His goods. Number two tonight, we notice the reckoning of faithfulness. You know that there is coming a reckoning day. Now the Bible goes on, if you'll go back to Matthew chapter 25, and I want you to notice verse number 16, because this describes to us the reckoning. I understand tonight that I will stand before God one day. And I'm not going to have my wife to stand there, my children to stand there. I'm going to stand, and I will give a personal accountability to God Almighty. I'm thankful tonight to know that I will not have to stand in judgment for my sin because Jesus paid for my sin. And I put my faith and trust in Him and thank the Lord for that. But I'm going to give an account. Can I tell you what I'm going to give an account for? What He delivered unto me. What He gave to me, He has delivered unto me His goods. Look what the Bible says, and let's begin in verse number 16. It says, "Then he that had received the five talents went and traded with the same and made them other five talents. And likewise, he that had received two, he also gained other two. But he that had received one went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them." Now there's coming a reckoning day, a day when every graduate will stand before God and you will give an account of what has been delivered unto you. For 4 years in college, God has delivered unto you his goods, his influence, teachers that have loved you and prayed for you and have delivered unto you those goods. And God has been good and gracious. You high school students, what God has done in your life and heart, your parents, and what they have delivered unto you, I am going to give an account before God. Now, I personally believe that I will stand before God and I will give an account for the ability that God has given to me. No two people's ability are the same. I'm going to stand before God with someone else's ability, but with the ability that God has given to me. But I believe also I will stand before God with my opportunity. You see, no two people have the same opportunity, but they are God-given. And I will give an account, and I will be honest with you tonight. I do not know that there is a more terrifying thought for every one of us than the day that we will stand before God. He will know our motives. He will know why we did what we did. If we did it to be seen of men, I'm sorry, but we have our reward. If we did it to be honored and praised, that is your reward. If we did it to bring glory to self, that is your reward. And it will be burned up. But I pray that we can stand before the Lord one day. And I don't know about you, but I desire to hear my Savior simply say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." By the way, the goodness is not because of us, it's because of Jesus Christ. And the faithfulness is our responsibility because there is coming that reckoning day. I love the hymn that says, "By and by, when I look on his face, thorn-shadowed face, what does it say? I wish I had given him more." There's coming a reckoning day. And you know something? We should think about that day that we will stand before God and that we will give an account. Let's take our Bibles, if you would, please, and let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter number 5 and verse number 10, because I want you to see this. Now, brethren, tonight, where does our faithfulness to God begin? You say, "Well, Pastor, I tell you what, I'm going to really work at this faithfulness. I'm going to really strive at being faithful to God." But our faithfulness to God always begins in our hearts. So many Christians live such surface lives. They take care of the public world, but they really ignore the private world. Because it is in the private, secret place of our heart where our faithfulness to God begins. You see, God sees whether or not we're really faithful. He knows it. Years ago, on October the 25th, 1999, there was a Learjet that taxied down the runway in Orlando, and it was heading to Dallas, Texas. But somewhere over Gainesville, Georgia, the plane made a left turn and, not heading towards Texas, now it veered off course, heading towards South Dakota. Obviously, the tower began to radio, and what is going on? You're off course. You need to get back on course, and no response. Multiple requests and no response until finally the Air Force sent up two F-16 fighter pilots to go up to see, to get close enough to this plane. And as they got close enough, they were able to see that all of the windows were iced over, and no doubt that everybody on board was unconscious. They had lost no doubt the cabin pressure in the plane. Nothing that they could do, and of course, not long after that, the plane crashed, and everyone on board died, and One of the famous ones was golfer Payne Stewart that died that day. You say, well, preacher, what does that have to do with anything? I want you to imagine just for a minute standing maybe in your backyard, and you look ahead and you see that plane that goes across. It looks like it's on course. It looks like it is heading to its destination, but you have no idea that there is major trouble inside the plane. To you, everything is fine. But inside the plane, there was great trouble. There was great disaster that was coming. I wonder how many times that we look at people and we think everything looks like it's in place, but deep in the heart, there is unfaithfulness to God that is eventually going to come out. Because our faithfulness to God begins in the private, secret place of our heart. That is where it begins. And that is what we must give attention to, is that our heart is right with God, that we are faithful to God in the private, secret place of our heart. Is it not true of David when he was the young man, the man after God's own heart, that everybody overlooked David, but God knew that he had found a man? God knew that on that countryside when David tended the sheep and David took care of them, that David was a man after God's own heart. But when Samuel came to anoint the next king, and everybody overlooked David, but God didn't overlook him, because God saw what nobody else could see. He saw faithfulness in David's heart. And tonight, God's call for faithfulness always begins in the heart. We come to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and we look in verse number 10. The Bible says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Now let's not stop there, because let's read on. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest unto God. And I trust also are made manifest in your consciences. For we commend not ourselves again unto you, but give you occasion to glory on our behalf, that ye may have somewhat to answer them which glory in appearance and not in heart. Before I read on, young people tonight, do you just glory in the appearance but not in heart? Because God is looking for faithfulness, not on the outside, but in our hearts. We read on, verse 13. For whether we be beside ourselves, it is to God, or whether we be sober, it is for your cause. And look at this. For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. Now I want to say this to you tonight. Faithfulness to God, it is a matter of the heart. But what is going to keep you faithful to Him? I believe it is verse number 14. It is the love of Jesus Christ. Now, I do not believe that Paul is talking about his love for the Lord, because our love, sadly, wavers, does it not? Our love is not what it should be at all times. But I believe that Paul is saying, the love of Jesus for me has gotten such a hold of me that it constrains me to live my life for Jesus Christ. Amen. Can I encourage you tonight to bask, to dwell upon the love of God for you? Because that constrains us. Brother, I'm going to tell you something. His love for me has gotten such a hold of me that I've got to serve Him, and I want to be faithful to Him because He is faithful to me. It's gotten a hold of me. I cannot sin against that love for me. Years ago when I was a teenager, and I had a time when I was wavered for the Lord, and I'm not proud of it. I'm embarrassed by it. But God in His mercy forgave and cleansed me. But one night I came back to my mom and dad's room to ask them something. You know, teenagers, they always got questions or needing something. I was probably hungry. I'm probably at that point. But I came back to their room, and the door was open, the light was off, but I heard talking. I probably shouldn't have, but I got closer to where I could hear. My mom and dad were praying for me. I want to tell you something. I heard them praying. I heard my mama cry out to God, and I heard my daddy cry out. I heard it. I went back to my room and I struggled with that because, man, I was living for self. I was concerned about me and what my plans and my wishes, but that got a hold of me. Their love for me. And tonight, graduates, get a hold of God's love for you, that He has delivered unto you His goods, that we have a responsibility to His faithfulness, and that we will stand before Him one day. We will have a great reckoning day. Oh, may God help us. Number three, the last thing that we notice tonight is not only our responsibility to faithfulness, the reckoning of faithfulness, but number three, the reward of faithfulness. I want you to take your Bibles and go back to Matthew chapter 25, if you would, please. Now, the reward. I ran track when I was in high school, and I enjoyed it. But I remember one season in particular that I had not practiced. I had not run. I had not done what I should have done. I was not responsible for my, track and all that had been given unto me, practices, all of that. And I did not do well. And I remember coming to the end of the year, kind of like a graduation ceremony like this, and they gave out the awards. And I can still remember where I was sitting, and I thought to myself, Lord, why didn't I work harder? Lord, I wasted this time that you gave to me. No reward was given. And there's coming a day that we will stand before our Heavenly Father. And can I tell you something? The emphasis in Matthew chapter 25 is not on the talents, it is on faithfulness. The emphasis is not on the size, it is on the sort. It is on the quality. I'm a pastor, and sometimes you can get pretty discouraged as a preacher. And you can think, well, I'm not pastoring as many people they are, and I'm not doing what they are doing, but I'm not standing before God with that measurement. I am standing before God and give an account for what He has delivered unto me. Was I faithful to Jesus Christ? And that is God's call tonight, that we can answer the call. And Lord, whatever you deliver unto me, by God's grace and by your divine enablement, I will be faithful to you. But tonight, the reward of faithfulness. Think of it. Let's go back to our passage, if you would, please, in Matthew chapter 25. And we'll look in verse number 20. And it says, and so he that had received five talents came and brought other five talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me five talents. Behold, I have gained beside them five talents more. Now, I think the key is that he said, Lord, you delivered this to me, and here's what I've done for thee. Look in verse 21. Here's the reward. It's the reward that I believe all of us desire to have. Listen, it is not so that we can get a crown to prance around heaven and to bring glory to ourselves. It is a crown to lay at the feet of our Savior, Jesus Christ. To lay at His feet. Oh, think of it tonight. The reward for our faithfulness. But look in verse 21. His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. You know, the Bible goes on to talk about the other man with the two talents. But then look in verse 24. Then he which had received the one talent came and said, Lord, I knew that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown and gathering where thou hast not strawed. Now, I want to stop and say this to you. I find a man who just gave excuses. Lord, you don't understand my background. You don't understand how I grew up. You don't understand the difficulties that I've had in life. Every one of us here tonight, we have had trouble. We have had trials. We have had wounds. We have had heartaches. We are broken people, every single one of us. And yet, sometimes we can almost excuse our lack of faithfulness because of something in our past. But may I say to you tonight that God, by His wisdom and His grace, enables each and every one of us, no matter what we have gone through, no matter what we deal with, no matter the trials that we face, we can be faithful because He is faithful to us. We can live a faithful life unto the Lord, and we just simply need to answer God's call. Yes, Lord, I will be faithful. we find the man gave excuses. But look in verse 25. And then he said this, and I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine. The man said, Lord, I was afraid. I was scared. And I remember when God put it in my heart to preach. I argued with the Lord. I said, Lord, you know the grade I got in speech class, and it wasn't good. And Lord, you know that I have a hard time. I remember we had a man in our church that had a hard time looking people in the eyes. I was so bashful and scared, and every time he'd see me, hey, look at me in the eyes, son, look at me in the eyes. I really didn't want to look at him, you know. But I was afraid, and I said to the Lord, God, this is not a good ideal. Lord, you need someone better. You need someone with gifting and talent. But you know, simply put, I was afraid. And yet I said, Lord, I surrender. I give you my life. And Lord, you know what is best. And yet this man said, Lord, I was afraid. Is fear going to keep you from standing before the judgment seat of Christ and having a good judgment day? I tell our church, I believe one of my greatest responsibilities is to get you ready for a good judgment day before God. A reckoning day that you will stand. We read on here, and look what the answer. His Lord answered, verse 26, and said unto him, thou wicked and slothful servant. Tonight, do you know, we sometimes think, well, faithfulness or unfaithfulness is not really a big deal. But God said, thou wicked and slothful servant. You see, the reward is that our Heavenly Father can look upon us. He knows our background. He knows everything in our life. And by the way, He is divinely interested in each and every one of us. He has called each and every one of us, and He has delivered unto all of us His goods. What will you do with what God has delivered unto you? I pray that day that all of us, the Lord could say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Now, brethren, I want to end with this very thing. Let's take our Bibles, go to Hebrews chapter number 3. As I said before, our faithfulness to God is not really dependent on our wisdom, our wit, our ingenuity, our strength. I used to think that the Christian life was about me working harder. Well, I'm going to work harder at this Christian life. I'm going to strive harder. But can I tell you something? The Christian life is impossible without Jesus Christ. Amen. We get saved by faith, and then we try to serve by our own strength. Right. We get saved by putting our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and then we think God just leaves us to ourselves to try to live and strive and do it in our own strength, and we fail. Because my faithfulness to God is not conditioned upon my faithfulness in my own strength. It is His faithfulness to me. Now tonight, I just want to end with this. Let us look unto the faithful one. He is faithful to you and me. Man, I'm so grateful for God's faithfulness, because I couldn't stand, I could not live without His faithfulness to me. And tonight, I am not dependent on my strength. I'm dependent on His strength, which is a wonderful strength. He is the all-powerful one. He is the all-knowing one. And I'm looking to Him, the faithful one. Now, Hebrews chapter number 3, I love the book of Hebrews. And we come to Hebrews chapter 3 and verse number 1. It says, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus. And tonight, let us consider Him. Look to Him tonight. Look in verse number 2. Who was faithful to Him that appointed Him? As also Moses was faithful in all his house. For this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who hath builded the house hath more honor than the house. For every house is builded by some man, but he that built all things is God. Who was faithful to him. I want you to look tonight to the faithful one who enables us to be faithful. And let me just simply say this to you tonight. Faithfulness to God enables me to be faithful in every other area of my life. You see, when I'm faithful to God, I'll be faithful to my wife. When I'm faithful to God, I'll be faithful to my children. When I'm faithful to God, I will be faithful to the church that God has given me to pastor. You see, it is faithfulness to him, but it's not dependent on my own strength. It is not dependent on my own work, on my striving. We are striving according to his working. Yes. For it is Christ which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Amen. You see, it is him. You see, 1 Thessalonians 5:24, we will not turn there, but I love this verse. Faithful is he. Tonight, that's the key. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. It's not me doing it. It's not me. It's not my strength. It is not my, and it is trusting in him. Pastor Chris Starr is here tonight, probably my best friend in the ministry. And I told stories about him last night. I'll hold off tonight on that, all right? But I'll never forget that we were getting ready to head out to go to Georgia. And I was going to preach to a bunch of teenagers. They told me there would be about 100 teenagers there. Brother, if there would have been 2 teenagers there, I'd still been scared half to death. And I remember that night, we were leaving the next morning, and I was scared. I told the Lord, I got alone with him, and I said, God, I cannot do this. Lord, I can't do it. And I read my Bible, and I didn't get anything. And I prayed, and I called out to the Lord. And I prayed, and I sought God. And I said, Lord, I'm not leaving this room until you give me the strength and you give me that confidence to know that you will do it. Well, I'm going to just be honest with you. You know, I wasn't getting anything. And I remember that I was broken before God, and I said, God, I just ask you to do what only you can do. And I came across a verse where the Bible says that he will light your candle. And in that moment, I said, God, I just want you to light my candle, and I just want you to do it. And you know something? I still was scared to death as I left that room. I was scared to death as we flew in to where we were supposed to be. And I remember that night getting up from those teenagers. I thought, man, I was 150 pounds soaking wet. I thought, they're going to take over and kill me right here and then, you know, and bury me here. But I remember that night I preached. I'm going to be honest with you. It was the worst message you've ever heard in your whole life. But God showed up on the scene. And when teenagers were walking down the aisle to get saved, the Lord said, son, it's not you. It's me doing it through you. I just need a vessel. And oh, often in life, I have said, God, I didn't choose myself. You chose me. And Lord, I just want to be a vessel. And God, help me. Do the work that I can never do. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. He does the work. He enables you. He strengthens you because he is faithful. In fact, Hudson Taylor, the great missionary, said this, God is not looking for men of great faith. He is looking for common men to trust his great faithfulness. You know what Hudson Taylor was? A common man who just trusted God's great faithfulness. He went on to say, all God's giants have been weak men and women who have gotten a hold of God's faithfulness. In fact, by 37 years of age, Hudson Taylor had already founded the China Inland Mission, and he was seeing a great measure of what people would say success, but yet he thirsted for personal greater victory within his heart. And although he knew that there was greater victory in Christ that was available, he somehow was not able to access that victory and that strength. In the deep time of heart searching, Hudson Taylor received a letter from a colleague in the mission named McCarthy. And McCarthy was on the same similar journey of trusting in God's faithfulness and finding that he is the one who does it. And in the letter, he wrote something that changed the life of Hudson Taylor. And this is what he wrote. McCarthy said, "It is not a striving to have faith, but a looking off to the faithful one that seems we all we need." He knew faith was the victory, but he had been focusing on his faithfulness, his journey of faith, his enablement. But when he looked unto the object of our faith, who is Jesus Christ, that is where he found strength to be faithful to God. Graduates tonight, it is not your work, it is not your labor, it is not you leaving here to try to make some name for yourself to be successful. Can I tell you what it is? It is looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. It is depending on his faithfulness. Because he is faithful to me, I can be faithful in every other area. Because he is faithful, I can withstand sin and I can be victorious in my Christian life. Because he is victorious and I'm depending and I'm trusting and I'm relying upon him. Oh, tonight, it is not what we can do in our own strength. It is not our striving for faithfulness. It is looking to the faithful one. Tonight, there's a call of God's faithfulness. Will you answer the call tonight? Will you simply say, "God, I want to stand before you and hear you say, 'Well done, thou good and faithful servant.' Well done." We have a little basketball team at our Christian school, and I get to ref some of those games sometimes. Those little kids, they're out there. They make a basket. They get a big smile on their face. I'm the preacher. They don't look at me and see if I'm proud of them. They look up in the stands, and they're looking for the smile of their daddy or their mama that says, "Buddy, good job." Now, I'm not looking for approval of man. I'm looking for the approval of my Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm waiting to hear, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." Let's bow our heads in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we love you tonight. And we thank you that you are faithful to us. Oh God, thank you that day by day we can rest and count on your faithfulness because you change not. Thank you that we can look to you day by day. You will give us strength. And Lord, you, the one who neither slumbers nor sleep, Lord, you will enable us every moment of every day and every trial and every difficulty to remain faithful because you are faithful to us. I pray for every graduate that is represented here tonight, that they would look away from their own strength and their own ability, but they would look to you who enables them to be faithful. Lord, we praise you tonight. We glory in your faithfulness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
At this time, it's my pleasure to present to you the graduating class of Fairhaven Christian Academy for the year 2023. Luke Armacost. Ian Davidson. Hannah Gross. Thomas Knowles. Arizona Ray. Israel Ray. Jonathan Rose. Rebellus Soto. It's all right. We can applaud. We'll applaud for them all at the end, but that's fine. Samantha Valadares. There's a lot of answered prayers going across this stage. Let's give them all a round of applause. It gives me great pleasure to present to you the graduating class of Fairhaven Baptist College for the year 2023. The following students are receiving a ministry service certificate. Danza Jensen. Megan Kirksey. Jeremy Diaz. The following students are receiving an Associate of Arts in Graphic Design. Desiree Davila. Yeah! The following students are receiving an Associate of Arts in Church Office Administration. Katie Brader. Amanda Krigo. Anna Dirks. Narissa Graham. Following students are receiving an Associate of Arts in Bible. Andrew Buttrell. Ellie Williamson. The following students are receiving a Bachelor of Science in Elementary Education. Mandy Brader. Yeah. Hannah Moody. Megan Muller. Abby Samples. The following students are receiving a Bachelor of Science in Secondary Education. Alicia Bottrell. Emily Reinhardt. Caitlin Scherzer. The following students are receiving a Bachelor of Arts in Missions. Daniel Grab. Samuel Harvey. Following students are receiving a Bachelor of Arts in Pastoral Theology and Music. Andrew Schreiber. Brandon Starr. The following students are receiving a Bachelor of Arts in Pastoral Theology. John Bottrell. Eliomark Gachet. Caleb Moody. Jackson Reardon. Zach Zadarsky. If you have any more applause, you can go ahead and give them all a round of applause.
Well, that's a lot of fun. I didn't realize how enjoyable that job would be. Watching these folks come across, what a special moment. What a special moment. We have one more presentation to make. Pastor and Mrs. Dan Armacost. They joined us in 1993. They are Fairhaven Baptist College graduates and have been foundational in the ministries of this church for 30 years. God gave them 4 children, Levi, Juliana, Annette, and Luke. They've been a great blessing to our church family. One of their many ministries has been the LaPorte bus route. We've enjoyed watching them serve together as a family. And if I could replay a film of the last 30 years, we would see the Armacost family at every church event, from the setup stage to the final cleanup. One might think they would be slowing down after so many years of service, but instead, Dan and Jennifer have answered God's call and are preparing to head to the mission field of Myanmar in January of next year. While we're going to miss them greatly, we're excited and honored to be their sending church. Levi and his wife Bethany and their little son Jack are currently serving at Grace Baptist Church in Urbana, Ohio with Pastor Samples. Juliana will be marrying her fiance, her sweetheart, John Betrell, in August, and they'll be joining our staff here at Fairhaven. Annette and Luke will continue their education here at Fairhaven Baptist College in August. We look forward to watching the Lord's hand of blessing in their lives as they continue to serve Him. Pastor, Mrs. Armacost, and the 4 kids, would you come on up here? My wife is going to help me. She's not an Armacost. To honor the many years of service, we have planned an exciting family day for you. Anyone who knows the Armacost know they love the Baltimore Orioles. So we want them to pick a date when they can all go to Camden Yards Stadium in Baltimore and enjoy a game together. And we want to pay for the traveling expenses, pay for those traveling expenses, hotel, meals, tickets, etc., and hope they enjoy these games to commemorate the 30 years. Of course, we have a team shirt for everyone with the number 30 on the back. And we even have one for Jack. Let's give them a round of applause.
What day?
sing God Bless America together as we finish.
God bless America.
Rock, who will be taking Pastor Armacost's place as Dean of Students, will close our night in prayer.
Lord, it's been a wonderful evening, and it's been a great time together. And Lord, we do thank you for all the commitment, all the hard work, all the investment that's been put in. And Lord, I pray that we'd see this as a wonderful investment that many, many people have made. And we thank you most of all for what you've given to us in salvation, making all of this possible. Lord, we commit this great investment to you now as we see these young people, many of them head out into ministry, and we see many of them go on to serve you. We pray, God, that we would be, as was preached tonight, faithful in your work. Thank you, God, for making all this possible. Please bless this evening. Thank you for all these that have come out tonight. In Christ's name I pray, amen. You're dismissed. Thank you.